morning, everyone. I'm so glad and happy to be in this place. If you see me looping a little bit, I just twisted. 2 weeks ago, I twisted my ankle trying to be younger. They masked it away somehow, you know, came down. Jericho came down. And they told me that I have to wear boots for 4 weeks. It's been 3 weeks already. The other one, I left it. I mean, my boots, I left it in the car. I said that to my wife, look, I look so bad without boots. And she said, yeah, well, health is first. And I said, baby, give me a chance. Let me wrap it up something around me. Act like I'm okay. And then when she saw me, and she said, hey, you look like Jacob. And I said, okay, let me, I'm just gonna hold so I get the blessing today, amen? So if you see me like that, please don't make fun of me. I'm coming on behalf of the Atlantic Union Youth Department. As you know, we have 6 conferences in our union, including one in the Bermuda Island. And we have around 120,500 members in our union. We have around 30% of that are young adults. Around 10,344 pathfinders, 9,343 adventurers. So that's what we have right now related to the youth adventurers, pathfinders in our union. We have more than 800 colleges, campuses all around the union, and we're looking forward to work at least with some of them to help those young people that are in college, in non-Adventist college, to see how can we help them so they can keep their faith. We have around 70% of the young people are leaving the church. And so that means that those that are here, more than half, you will not see when they become 18. So pray for the young people, amen? We recently had a Compassion Weekend in Rochester. With a media conference. I know I don't know how far from here, Rochester, but we had a couple weeks ago a community service project. During that weekend, we had more than 500 young people across the union serving the community with more than 100 projects. I have a video, but we don't have the time. It's 12 o'clock. They told me that 12:30, we will be 100 here. So I'm aiming to finish by 3, not by 12:30, so I have to be very careful. However, I'm from the Dominican Republic, as you can see my accent, amen. I'm from the Dominican Republic, where our Pastor Gomez was born. Pastor Gomez and we met a long time ago. We met in Attendant College, where we studied theology like 13 years ago. Year 2000? Oh, no. But I'm still young, amen. Amen. And I don't see the beautiful wife and children. Thank you so much for the invitation. I told Pastor Gomez, I don't know if they're going to invite me again. However, I'm going to try to do my best. Amen. So please pray for me. My wife and I, we've been married for 15 years. And it has been an awesome time for me. I don't know for her. But she's been very patient with me. We have a beautiful baby, Melanie. She went to sleep, so she will come in a couple of minutes. She's also, she got a feeling, she's in her tank. So they will come very soon. However, I have something very special for the mothers. Do we have any mothers here? Can you please watch, all of us, let's watch one video that I have, maybe two. And then I have something very special for you. And we want to also pray for the mothers that are here. I know it's tomorrow, but you know how we are, Adventists. Where's my phone? Okay. If you see me with my phone, I use it as a remote. I control my computer with my phone, so please don't think that I'm playing any games. I'm just, I press here, and then it will go there. So I have a video. Please watch it. I use this on the phone.
There are those who say that this is ordinary, but don't let that fool you. greatest, least ordinary, most difficult, utterly challenging career that anyone ever hopes to lay claim to. While others might hear, diaper changer, food maker, laundry doer, carpooler, bottle washer, sweatpants wearer, life on hold, want to be doing anything else for them. The truth is, whether it feels like it some days or not, you are in fact a shelter from the storm. You are a cape of good hope. You are a warrior who will do battle for your children's hearts, souls, attention, innocence, education, and memories. Go to battle, my friends. This is your time. We will hold strong on either side of you. We will pray for those bottles through the dark watches of the night. And when doubt comes and children break, when adults fail them, and when they push and push as hard against us as the day we delivered them into this world, we will not be broken. We may ache and see cracks tear through our hearts, but we will get up again tomorrow, and we will load the clothes and the words that need to be said again and again and again. When the world tries to claw at them, to break them, to smash the beauty in them, may our walls hold true. May the lessons we've taught, the truths we've lived, the life we've spoken into them come back easily, predictably, with wash and repeat ease. Kingdom business, Jesus work, this shaping of souls, this raising tiny humans. There are those that say this is ordinary. Don't buy it for a second. Mighty, you are mighty because you love.
Put a second one. I think the second one will also send a good message to the mothers that are here. And in this video, in other words, I want to say thank you to all the mothers. Can you hear well back there with you speaking? Is that bad? Thank you. One, two. Amen. So at this moment, I want to call all the mothers in front, please. I have something very special for you. Don't feel bad. Don't worry. You will have me just for 30 minutes, and that's it. You get rid of me. So come here, mother. Come here. Don't be shy. And I want one or two gentlemen to come forward and help me out. Give them a special pin that I have for them. I have a pin of compassion here, which is our ministry that we have in the union where we do community service, and we thank God for the compassion that He has given to the mothers. So this pin is just for you. Thank you so much. I give one to each mother. To each mother. Mother. Grandmother, great-great-grandmother. Bless all the mothers who have come into our lives, whose kindness, care, and loving remain with us to guide. Your inspiration in us made us strive in every way, especially to remember helping others make our day. Mothers, this little tribute flows directly from my heart, or our hearts here. You are so loved and cherished. You are loved, and thank you for everything. You are very compassionate, and we want to pray for you at this moment. Is that okay? Can we all stand at this moment and have a special prayer for our mothers? Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that you fill a mother's heart with love and compassion, that you have instilled in her very being the need to protect her children at all possible. Thank you for giving her the gift of nurturing her children, of teaching them and comforting them, for feeding them and making them as in a safe place, for guiding them to be all that God has created them to be. Fill every mother with love, wisdom, and endurance, with strength and patience and joy. Oh God, I plead and ask you to give them ability to forgive again and again. Enable them to rely on you and call upon you, because you will give her all she needs. In your precious name, O Lord, I also ask you for those mothers who care for us when we were helpless, for those mothers who comforted us when we were hurt, for those who love and care that we often took for granted. Today, O Lord, I pray for those who are grieving the loss of their mother, for those who never knew their biological mother and now yearn for her, those who have experienced the wonder of an adopted mother's love, the families separated by war or conflict, Lord, give them a special blessing. Keep us united with you and with each other, so that we can have and become what you meant to be, or what you meant us to be. I pray for all the mothers in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. You may have a seat. So my family, the title for the message is spoke in the valley. I know we have to program something in God's heart. But you know, as a preacher, we see things and feel things, and sometimes you give something to the pastor, and then you feel something else later. And I would like to bring hope for those that are in the middle of the valley. Amen? So, it's going to be based on Ezekiel chapter 37. This was from Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel means God is my strength. Whenever you see a name ending with E-L or beginning with E-L, whether it is Spanish, it has a connotation with God. Daniel, God is my judge. Emmanuel, God is with us. Ezekiel, God is my strength. And as you remember, Babylon captured the city of God. They invaded 3 times. Around 605, Babylonian or New Babylonian Empire, they said, okay, our gods are stronger, bigger, and greater than the Israel of God, and we will go and besiege the city. We will go and take captive to Babylon. So they went 605 before Christ, and they took their families, they took the prince, they took the intelligent ones, and they took them to Babylon. And then later on, around 597, 598, they came and they took Ezekiel, a priest, a young man around 30 years old, who was a priest and a prophet, and he was taken captive. By 588 also, the third time they came, they destroyed everything, destroyed the temple, and they took according to their God with their hand. Well, they forgot that in the Bible, Daniel chapter 1 and verse 1 and so on, it was God who willingly allowed it, because their people were sinning, and a lot of witchcraft and a lot of darkness was amongst God's people, and God allowed them to go through that so they can learn. So Ezekiel now is captive. Ezekiel now is crying. He is in a river trying to figure out why God allows such things in their life. Why God allows some pains in his life and his family, even his wife died, and he could even mourn. But it was hard. So now God is placing him in a valley. God brings him, God put his hand upon him, and he put him in the middle of a valley. Why God allowed it? Why the valley in our lives? And not only that, what God allowed the Babylonians, look how powerful those people were, and look how the empire looked. They had many gods. I'm just going to give a little preview on how Babylon, according to the archaeologists, looked in the past. Beautiful gardens. Amazing, strong, impenetrable walls. The Ishtar Gate. They use the blue color because the blue is, it has a message with their God of power and creation, and was a very expensive color in the ancient time. They control the textiles. Their construction had a message of power. That was Babylon. They spoke another language. They had different philosophy. They changed people's name. In other words, they tried to change people's attitude, people's philosophy, people's religion.
Thank you.
You finished the sermon, right? were so many people that you don't have the chance to mingle with everybody and say, I know everybody. But after the sermon, he just bought it. On the last day, we made in the appeal for baptism and all that. At the end of everything, he came up to me. And he told me, they sent me here to destroy this church and to destroy the preacher. Every day, I made prayers to demons. And every time I was sitting there, I was cursing you, trying to find a way.
Four
knows why, and he was captive there, and he was suffering there, and he said, you know, this is my Patmos, this is my valley, no, this is going to happen. But the Bible says that the Lord came to him in a vision, and he was in the spirit of the Lord on the Sabbath, and thank God in his Patmos and in his problem, he was in the spirit of the Lord. Amen? So then he saw God put his hand upon him and said, don't be afraid. I am who I am. I have the key for the grave. Don't worry. And he thought that the church was going to be destroyed. And then God showed him that the church leaders and that the church was on God's hand. So my family, I want to invite you today to believe that God's hands is with you, upon you. And then I want you to believe that even though your family is going through some tribulation, just pray daily and tell God, please put your hands upon my children, put your hands upon my marriage, put your hands upon my finances, just put your hands. I want to feel hands upon me. In the middle of sin, in the middle of pain, the hand of Jehovah is upon me. In the middle of confusion and attack, the hand of the Lord is upon me. But the thing is that sometimes we don't feel it. It's 12:30. Can you give me 5 more minutes, 10 minutes? You say, no, I was always on the road. For the mothers. I like to respect time, but you know. And it's in the middle of a valley. And we all have valley experiences in our lives. If you have mountains, you have valleys. Remember that. But I want to encourage you that we learn more from our valley experiences than on our mountaintops. I know we all love to be in the mountaintop. We all love it. It is okay. I don't think it's wrong if you love to be in the mountaintop. But in the period of time in the valley, they can be short or long. Nevertheless, it is the place that you learn more about God. In the ancient time, people believed God would dwell in the mountaintop. The Israelites, they would find in the mountains. You know, God manifested himself in mountains. You can see that through the Bible. And he has a better theology just about the mountains. So there was a belief that the gods will dwell on top, and sometimes the God will not go to the valley. That was the belief. In some ancient religions out there in Mesopotamia. So the Hittites, for example, they were one of the first ones. The Hittites dwell in Anatolia, or what we call now Turkey. They invented or created the iron in the Iron Age. They were the one that had the iron. So you know, most of the Philistines or Philistines, whatever you call it, they learned from them and they used a lot of, you know, iron to fight. But the Israelites, they just used a piece of a rocks. They didn't know how to fight. So that's why they had to go to the mountains, because with those horses and chariots, you cannot really go up there, so from top they will win the battle. So there was in ancient time a king called Ben-Hadad, and he was saying, you know, we're going to have a problem, we're going to fight with the Israelites. So what we have been, you say, okay, let's fight, but well, I don't know if we're going to win. And the Lord sent a prophet and told him, look, you're going to fight. You're going to go, and I'm going to give you the victory. So God in the mountains, God gave them a victory in the mountains. So the king said, oh, that is why they won the battle, because they won in the mountains. Let's fight next time in the valley, and you will know that they will not win. So the Lord said, Well, I don't know if he said that, but the Lord looked at them and said, you know what? Tell the king that I'm not only a God, the God of the mountaintop, I'm also the God of the valley. And in the valley, God gave them the victory. Amen? So yes, we love the mountaintop. Yes, we love whatever belongings of things that God has given us. However, when you are in the valley, it's not easy. The length and the depth of the valley can increase depending also, let me see, in your attitude. So I want to say something real nice now, and maybe we should take that in consideration. Most of us are in a valley, or maybe you've been in a valley, or maybe you will be in a valley. Maybe you are in mountaintop, and amen. However, if you are in a valley, don't compare your valley with others. We tend to do that. We tend to place that person in my situation. Or if I'm here and the person is right there, we always want to bring them to where we are. Oh, we compare. Oh, no, that's nothing. Oh, the child left the church. Oh, that's nothing. Oh, you don't have money for the rent. Oh, that's nothing. Oh, you couldn't do that business. Oh, that's nothing. I've been there. Don't compare. Because you never know what things are behind the scene that nobody knows. That's why I like to come to God. Because he is the only one that knows how I was born. The trauma that I went when I was a child. The mistreatment that I received when I was a child. The things that I went through, like a girl told me, Pastor, my dad abused me. That's my valley. When I was a pastor, I had more than 7 or 8 kids who tried to commit suicide. And they said, Pastor, that's my valley. The mother had to call me at 11 o'clock Friday, say, Pastor, I just found my son trying to hang himself. And that was her valley. I had a church clerk who told me, Pastor, I hate my stepdad. Because when I was 12, he did something. I cannot forgive him. That's my valley. And I'm preaching for somebody here. Maybe it's only one that is going through a valley. That is going through a tribulation. That you look back and you remember that valley and you still cry. I am preaching for somebody here that you say, my body is too dark. I don't know what's going to happen with me. Well, there is something that I want to tell you. The Bible says, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, what? They comfort me. Someone said, if you are going to hell, keep moving, keep walking. Someone said, the valley, I think that guy addressed it right, that he wrote once, the valley is not our final destination. We must traverse it. If you're going through the hell, keep going, said Mr. Churchill. And another, William Penn said, no pain, no harm, no force, no throne, no God, no glory, no cross, no crown. So sometimes we have to go through pain to get the palm of victory. Sometimes we're going to have to go through the thorns in order to get the throne of God. Sometimes we got to go through the gall to get the glory. If we have no cross, we have no crown. This is something that the disciples wanted to do. He said, he multiplied the loaves and the bread and the fish. You know, he did that. Let's crown him as a king. So they were making a church board. They gathered the church board in the afternoon. They said, let's crown him. He is the Messiah for the earth. get the crown of glory. And I need to go through the pain to get the palm of victory. But they didn't understand that at that moment. And God had to allow them to go through the valley in order them to see the glory of God. Amen. So God is allowing sometimes the valleys in our needs. So faith chooses to survive what it cannot explain. The Bible says they will give her her back, her vineyards, and they will make the valley of Achor a door of hope. Look at this. Achor means tribulation. And Achor was just prior to the promised land. God told them, look, we took Jericho, so now we're going to take Ahab. But Joshua didn't consult them that much because Ai is a small city. So we don't need much prayer because it's small. I can do it. I have the ability to do it. I'm too smart. I graduated with 4.0 and I know what to do, how to do it. So God, you know, this is my time to forget myself. But Achan has seen and have a secret sin there. And his sin affected everybody. But it was prior to the promised land. Just minutes, just there. And they lost the Bible before an angel of the promised land. Yeah. And God is saying, you know, if you go into your acorn, right there, I want to open a door of hope. Just there. When you don't find anything, God is waiting to open a door of hope. And one thing that I want to remind you is that when you go through your valley, it's not a punishment, but it's a reminder that you are close to the promised land. As a church, we will go through a valley. You see that in the book of Revelation. You see how things are moving along in the U.S., church, state, and many other things going in that direction. And the Seventh-day Adventist church, we're going to go through the valley. But when we face that valley, number one, the hand of the Lord will be with us. And number two, a door of hope will be open for us. And number three, that will be a reminder that our redemption is near. So my family, I'm giving you just 3% of the sermon. I'm going to have to come back. I'm inviting myself with something. Hey, and I'm driving 4 hours and a half, trust me. And we have 562 churches in the Union. But I just want to leave you with this. He was placed in the valley. He was put in the valley. But one day, that captivity of the Babylonians with God's people ended. God has promised a time. They will go, yes, we're in Babylon. Yes, Babylon means future. Yes, it confuses what you're going to decide. It confuses what you're going to study. It confuses what things are going in your life. You are confused because Babylon, we are in Babylon right now. It's a symbolism of confusion and things that you do not understand. But right there in your confusion, in your Babylon, Daniel and his friends, and I'm General Ezekiel, and Ezekiel and his friends, they were faithful in the middle of the valley, in the middle of Babylon. They kept their faith to God. So whether you like it or not, remember this. You can stay faithful in your valley. Just walk through. Don't get used to your valley. There are people that are putting their tents there, and they're so used to sin, and they're so used to suffer, that they just accept their valley as the final destination. It is not. The Bible said, you gotta walk through. Walk. Don't stay. If you feel lost, those things you feel, will probably say, I'm gonna stand up, the hands of the Lord will support me, I'm gonna make it in the name of Jesus. I don't want any plans, but put it in God's hands, and you are going to make it. Amen. I don't believe it there. I give it 2%. I'm sorry, but you know, I like to spend time. God bless you and see you another time. Amen. Bless our hearts, bless our family, bless our mothers. And God, we long to see you face to face. In Jesus' name we pray.